So today let's make another episode of my Solid State Tesla Coil series, and today let's start building the circuit board. Of course, my unique way and with the shape of the heatsink in mind. So now let's start putting it very crudely together. Here is the copper heatsink with the transistors here and some other holes for maybe upgrading it to a bridge or maybe to put parallel pairs of transistors. And here's a very crude drawing of the board, which would go into it like this, to the transistors here. Here the voltage divider capacitors and some snubber network resistors and capacitors here. And the control chip, potentiometer, some capacitors, resistors, the big resistor here. And there could later be some kind of terminal block, bridge rectifier or single diode for rectification, maybe some interference filter or some bimetal overheat protection. And I will cut the board out of this huge copper board. It's just a single-sided board. I will cut it out and basically dremel it or make cuts in it where the lines are to separate the copper pieces from each other. So it's kind of SMD construction, but using through-hole components. And this has the advantage that everything is accessible. When you fix it or improve it or do some experiments, you don't have to access the other side of the board. The board can be screwed to it, and for every modification or repair, you never have to unscrew it, basically. And the board has nothing conductive from the other side. So you can basically just put it on the heatsink and nothing shorts out. So this is my very crude way of prototyping something or making something that's never going to go into a series production anyway. And this heatsink is actually copper, but it's of course plated with something. It's from some 90s server power supply probably. And the heatsink already has some holes in it with a thread. There are actually some iron pieces inserted into it with thread, and it's quite useful to have more holes. I can add transistors for a bridge or for parallel pairs, or I can add diodes if I ever use transistors with no built-in diodes. But now let's start making the board. Let's cut it using a very crude saw, and then let's cut the traces in the board using those bits for a mini drill. I basically put one of those into a mini drill and cut the traces. Some strange drill bits. They look like dentist drill bits. And this tiny one actually could really be a dentist one. And the other ones are from various sets, like those ones. So now it's mostly drawn. And it seems to fit nicely into the space, and I removed some of the copper from the edges of it for better isolation from the heatsink. And now let's start cutting the tracks. And it comes out nicely. The high voltage gaps are thick like paranoia, but anyway. And the low voltage gaps under the chip are going to be thinner, of course, using this dentist style bit. Nice. And then I of course also sandpaper it to get rid of the copper whiskers. But of course there is a place where this chip has the full mains voltage between two neighbor pins. Those two adjacent pins, pin 5 and 6, have the full mains voltage between them, but I have used this type of chip so many times and it never arced over. The board came out quite nicely. And normally I put chips into a socket, but in a switching power supply or power electronics, it's quite a bad idea, because in anything else, a poor contact will probably just make it stop working, but this power circuitry would blow up if there was a poor contact. If there is any poor contact in the control circuitry of power transistors, it destroys the transistors usually. And I even drilled the holes roughly in the right place. And now let's solder. So let's start soldering it. Let's turn this chip basically into an SMD component. And let's solder it SMD style. My soldering gun, some rosin, some leaded solder, of course, and let's try soldering it. So it's the chip, the diode, and now of course putting the voltage divider capacitors in place. That's it. Some heatsink compound under the transistors, of course, and the snubber networks and the gate resistors. Now testing just the chip using a bench power supply and with some random temporary components in the oscillator, and it runs at 106 kHz, which is roughly where it's going to run. And the chip draws about 12 milliamps at 15 volts. So it should be possible to run it using a resistive dropper. But of course the input current depends on the operating frequency. So this is the highest frequency I can imagine it running at. And at the highest frequency it draws 17 milliamps. So let's calculate the resistive dropper for about 20 or 25 milliamps. Getting some components from a power supply. And here's my cat pretending to have no feet. I have some old terminal blocks here, so let's give it some terminal blocks and a lot of other things. Some very old button for a doorbell. And some mechanical timers for stairwell lights. So now it has some terminal block for the mains input, terminal block for the output, some dropper resistors, some switch, the bridge rectifier which works as just one diode, some NTC thermistor, even though later I will probably put more in parallel, and some interference inductor, interference capacitor here, and I still plan to put another interference capacitor here, and the tuning potentiometer in it of course, somewhere here, and maybe some indication LEDs, and I can almost test it. So this is Dirk Wild, and see you in my next videos, and thanks to all of my patrons on Patreon, I really appreciate your support. And in the next episode I plan to make some tests and oscilloscope measurements, and some improvements based on those measurements. For example some current amplifiers for the gate drivers, to drive the gates faster.